today is the jugular vein and how to assess it clinically. It's a very important topic again. Of course, from the examination point of view, it's a very, very pet question for examiners, and again, a very weak spot for students. And of course, you can get quite a bit of useful information from the jugular vein even before you proceed to auscultation. So let's look at the usefulness of jugular venous pulse. Now, this is a video recording of the movement. See, in a cardiac patient, there are a number of things moving in the chest, moving in the neck. So you can see here, there's one sharp movement happening in the, probably that's an arterial pulse here. Then there is some retraction here with each respiration. Probably the patient is quite dyspneic and there is a tracheal tug here. And then there are visible veins on the surface of the skin, close to the surface of the skin, running over the sternomastoid, which are engorged. In addition, there are widespread pulsations going all the way up to the angle of the mandible. So a number of pulsations are there, and we have to differentiate between them and make useful conclusions from it. And that's what the study of the jugular venous pulse. Now, out of these, the tracheal tug is very easy to understand. The tracheal tug is a negative pull. It sucks the thorax in. Whenever there's labored breathing, the suprasternal nerve goes in during deep inhalation. Any dyspneic patient, you would have seen there is increased depression in the suprasternal nerve during inspiration, and the trachea is pulled down because there is resistance to inflation of the lung in interstitial edema and other conditions. Of course, a jerky, brisk arterial pulse, easy to identify. But a vast majority of diffuse pulsations and NENG are generally due to veins. All these are due to veins because the veins are all over the place. So when the venous pressure is elevated, you get pulsations in a number of places. So only when the venous pressure is not very elevated, you have to look too carefully in one or two particular areas. Okay. So let's first look at the anatomy of the jugular venous system. And this is what I meant, but there are veins all over the neck. You can see that the left brachiocephalic vein comes across the midline, and then you have the left-sided veins there. Right internal jugular vein comes and joins with the right subclavian vein to form the right brachiocephalic or innominate vein, which goes directly into the supravena cava and the right atrium. Now, the subclavian vein is under the clavicle, so that's not accessible to us. Now, the vein that is connected directly to the right atrium without absolutely any intervening turns, twists, or valves, or any obstruction is the internal jugular vein. Absolutely straight in line with the right atrium. And therefore, even the left internal jugular vein is slightly indirectly connected. Therefore, the vein which gives the most faithful reproduction of the RA pressure and RA volume changes occurs in the right internal jugular vein. There are other veins on the right side also. They're called the external jugular vein, one running parallel to the same line as the internal jugular vein, but on a more superficial plane, the subcutaneous tissue. And there is an anterior jugular vein which cuts across the sternomastoid and goes anteriorly in the paratracheal region. So these are also connected to the supravena cava. Therefore, they would also reflect RA pressure, but they are sort of indirect. No, there are twists and turns. Sometimes they may have valves. As they come out of the thorax, they have to penetrate the fascia here. And the fascia is a very tough fibrous structure. Therefore, there may be kinks. And it also depends on the position of the neck. If the position of the neck is bent, then this area may be kinked or that area may be kinked. And therefore, these veins may not give a true picture of the right atrial pressure. That is why generally it's not recommended to use the external jugular vein. What you see easily on the neck is the external jugular vein. That is generally not recommended. Actually, there is no problem in using external jugular vein, provided you're sure that there is no sharp turn and there is no obstruction. In some cases, you know, the veins are, external jugular veins are beautifully distended and they show beautiful A and V wave. And when the A and B were very clearly seen, even the external jugular vein can be used as a measure of venous pressure. But as a routine, when you talk of venous pressure measurement, you have to talk of internal jugular vein. The internal jugular vein is a deep structure. It is deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. It's deep to the fascia. And therefore, if somebody asks you, where have you seen the internal jugular vein? The answer is no. You never actually see the internal jugular vein. You only see the movement of the skin and muscles over the vein. You never see the actual vein. So the measurement is all done indirectly because the internal jugular vein pulsation are transmitted to the overlying structures. And that is also a source of difficulty because in obese people or a thick, short neck, you might not be able to visualize it properly. So that's in short is anatomy. But where venous pressure is engaged, you can understand why there are pulsations all over the neck. And you see the veins all over the right side of the neck. There's a vein in the midline also. And there's again veins all over the left side of the neck. Therefore, when the venous pressure is elevated, you actually get venous pulsations very, very widespread in the neck. Now, what is the surface anatomy of the jugular vein? The external jugular vein, as I said, runs in the subcutaneous tissue parallel to the sternomastoid muscle like this. And the anterior jugular vein cuts across the sternomastoid muscle going into the paratracheal region. As I said, the internal jugular vein is not seen, but there are certain landmarks. Now, this is the sternomastoid muscle. It has two heads. One is the clavicular head here, and other is the sternal head. So, these two heads join here and form a single muscle. Therefore, there's a small triangle here. This triangle is the location of the internal jugular vein closest to the neck here. From here, and this is probably the only place where this internal jugular vein is not covered by muscle, this triangle here. And as you go up, my vein lies deep to the muscle, and you have to draw a line from the apex of the triangle to the angle of the mandible or to the ear lobule, and that is the line of the internal jugular vein. So now you know where to look for the internal jugular pulsations would be behind the sternocleidomastoid muscle or just under the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Now, that's an important point to differentiate because carotid lies definitely anterior to the sternomastoid muscle. Carotid lies here in the immediate paratracheal gutter here. So, the carotid pulsations are medial to the sternomastoid, whereas the venous pulsations are predominantly lateral as well as underneath the sternomastoid muscle. That's a very important point. Now, this line here is a line you must use your anesthetist and critical care people when they try to take an internal jugular line. They aim for the apex of this triangle and then point to the right nipple posteriorly here. So as I told you, this is the most superficial location of the internal jugular vein here in this triangle. From here, it goes obliquely like this to the lobule of the ear. So that is the external anatomy of the jugular vein. Now, the method of examination is very important because, as I said, you never actually see the vein. You only see subtle movements of the skin and the muscle. And sometimes these movements are very... The examples of video I have recorded of showing today are actually a little exaggerated examples so that you understand easier. But in usual clinical practice, the movements may be very, very small, very, very subtle, and you have to examine very carefully for it. So there are certain principles. One is, you should have a source of light, and where should the source of light be? You should be at the same level as the skin, either posteriorly or anteriorly, one of the two places. Now, what you want to see is small movements of the skin, up and down, up and down. Therefore, your eyes have to be at the same level of the skin, tangential, and your source of light should also be at the same level of the skin in a tangential position. So, find a comfortable position for the patient. Turn the head to the opposite side halfway. Then have a source of light, a pen torch, at the level of the jugular vein. In this case, I have shown it posteriorly. And you should probably inspect it from here, like this. Or in case you have that light here, then you look at it from the posterior aspect. In that case, you can see small movements of the structures overlying the internal jugular vein. So the idea of seeing the internal jugular vein is to make sure it is indeed a venous pulsation and you're not confusing any other pulsation for the internal jugular vein. Then you want to make out waves, which I'll come to later. And finally, you want to have a rough estimate of the height of the venous column so that you know what is the pressure in the jugular vein, which in turn will reflect the pressure in the right atrium, which in turn will tell you about the condition of the heart. Therefore, how do you measure the venous pressure? You examine the venous pulsation and the venous column, and you take the uppermost point of the venous column. That is the point you take for the measurement of venous pressure. Now, before you do that, you must be very sure that the venous pulsation are clearly differentiated from arterial pulsation. And some of the differences I've already told you. The venous pulsations are lateral and more superficial. They're deeper and more medial in the neck. The venous pulsations are not very strong. Therefore, you see them very well. But if you put your hand, sometimes they disappear. Whereas the carotid pulsations are always better felt. There are multiple waves in every cardiac cycle in the vein. Because they have an A wave and an X descent, they have a V wave and a Y descent. Therefore, multiple movements will be seen for each cardiac cycle. The arterial pulse, all of you are familiar, you have a single upstroke. Now, very often it is very easy to see the descent. The withdrawal of the vein is much easier to identify than the positive wave. Whereas the upstroke of the carotid is always best visible, even from a distance. Okay? Now, during respiration, normally the intrathoracic pressure drops. And therefore, the blood is drained from the jugular vein into the right atrium. Therefore, the venous pressure drops. However, there is a little paradox here. The mean venous pressure drops during inspiration, but the waves become better visible during inspiration. Now, the reason is the waves are much better seen when the veins are not very engorged, because the veins are collapsed and then a wave will be better seen. If the vein is already engorged, then the wave will not be seen very well. And finally, if you're still not sure, all you have to do is press at the root of the neck, and which abolish venous pulsation, but arterial pulsation cannot be abolished by pressure. So look at this jugular vein pulse. Again, as I said, there are multiple pulsations again. Now, they're pressing the root of the neck. Can you see the pulsations immediately stopped here? Now look, there are multiple pulsations. You can see two pulsations for every arterial pulse. Now, to identify the arterial pulse, can you see? One second, let me start at the beginning. You watch here, there's a brisk movement, which is the carotid pulse that helps you time here. And if you watch here, you'll see two waves. So for every one arterial pulse, there are two waves that indicate it's a venous pulse. And then when that person puts a thumb here and presses the root of the neck, the pulsations immediately stop. That means the RA pulsation are not able to conduct to the internal jugular vein. Now watch again. You see that? The pulsations stop immediately. And then when you remove the finger, the pulsations appear again. So that's the simplest test to make out. That is what you're seeing is really venous pulsation. In fact, when the venous pressure is high, it can go to the angle of the mandible and even above the angle of the mandible. And therefore, the sign of a very elevated venous pressure may be the movement of the ear lobule. You know? Gentle to and fro movements of the ear lobule, which is pushed by the internal jugular vein, which lies just under the angle of the mandible here. Now, once you have identified the top of the venous column, we have to measure the vertical height above the right atrium. Now, obviously, you don't have access to the right atrium. Therefore, we have to make some assumptions here. The average height of the manubrium sternum or the sternal angle from the right atrium is said to be 5 centimeters. That's the average height, mind you. It doesn't apply to everybody, doesn't apply to children. And it may vary from person to person, but the average height is supposed to be 5 centimeters. Now, since you do not have access to the right atrium, you use this as a starting point. You need a scale like this. That is a measuring scale. And you need another scale to make sure that you're measuring at the top of the venous column. So you need a pencil or a scale to indicate the top of the venous column, and you need a vertical scale. So the vertical height of the venous column above the angle of the mandible is from this point to this point. Okay? Now, suppose this is 3 centimeters. So this is 3 centimeters, and you have another 5 centimeters distance between the manubrium and the right atrium. Therefore, the total is 5 plus 3 equal to 8 centimeters. 8 centimeters of water. Because blood is largely water, so the pressure is expressed as water. So if you have a 3 centimeter vertical height above the sternal angle, it is equal to 8 centimeters of water pressure. Approximate right atrial pressure is 8 centimeters of water. Now, last time we discussed that if you want to convert this to mercury, it's a simple, because density of mercury is different, you have to multiply it by 0.75, and therefore 8 will become something like 6.5 or something like that, millimeters of mercury. Therefore, that normal pressure. Now, there are some problems in doing this. One is, not everybody is of the same build. Therefore, this 5 centimeters may not be 5. In some, it may be only 4 centimeters. In some, maybe only 3 centimeters. In others, it may be 7 centimeters. Therefore, that is one source of the sort of discrepancy in them. Therefore, some of the newer texts have sort of said, why don't you do away with this addition of 5? Just report it how high it is above the sternal angle. And by definition, they just consider it about 4 centimeters above the sternal angle is up to that is normal, and more than that is abnormal. That's a shortcut to do that. The other problem is, if the venous pressure is very high, you cannot make out the upper level of the venous column. Suppose the venous pressure is at the angle of the mandible and even higher, the venous pressure is here. You can't make out the upper level of the venous column. Therefore, you cannot measure, even if the venous column is here, the maximum height would be about 8 centimeters and another 5, 8 plus 5, 13 centimeters, equal to about 10 millimeters of mercury. Now, suppose you have a patient with the RA pressure is about 15, the venous pressure will be intracranial, and therefore the JVP will not be in a position to measure. So what do you do then? One thing you can do, if it is only mildly elevated above the mandible, you can bring it down by making the patient more erect. From the 45 or 30 degrees, you can make the patient more erect, and therefore the venous column would come down a little bit. Mind you, the vertical height remains the same. Whether you measure in 45 degrees or you measure in 60 degrees or whether you're 90 degrees, the vertical height will remain the same. Right? So you make the patient sit up and measure the vertical height from the sternal angle. There are some recent books who want to simplify the venous pressure measurement even more. And they say, since most of the patients are being examined in the outpatient and they are in the sitting position, why don't we make it a routine to measure the venous pressure only in the sitting position? And instead of measuring it from the sternal angle, why don't we just measure it from the medial end of the clavicle? So you just report so many centimeters above the medial end of the clavicle. Now, the normal venous pressure is about 6 to 8. Okay? That means the sternal angle is 5 centimeters above the RA, and the clavicle is another 3 centimeters above the sternal angle. Therefore, if the venous column is visible above the medial end of the clavicle, it has to be abnormal. You get my point? Therefore, they say if the patient is sitting in your outpatient and just examine the patient in the sitting position, and whatever level you see above the medial end of the clavicle, just report it as it is, 4 centimeters above the medial end of the clavicle. That means the normal venous pressure is 8 centimeters of water plus this 4 centimeters. That means RA pressure is equal to 12 centimeters of water equal to about 10 millimeters of mercury. Is that clear? So in the examination, if you are asked, you have to describe both the methods. You describe that the conventional method is measure it from the sternal angle, add 5 centimeters to that to compensate for the distance from RA to sternal angle, and express it in centimeters of water or millimeters of mercury. Because most patients are examined in the sitting position and for outpatient purposes, it is also equally valid to examine a patient in the sitting position and report it from the medial end of the clavicle. Okay? If the examiner asks you, you please tell him that you know both the methods. Both are correct. The first one is the conventional, traditional method. The second one is the one proposed for our routine day-to-day use. Is that clear? This is what somebody asked me last time. You with me?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. If anybody has any questions, just put a message and Nikhil can stop and ask me the question. Somebody can ask me the question. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Now, sometimes the veins are engorged above the angle of the mandible and they may not be able to measure. Then you have to look for other areas. This is one way of measuring engorged veins. See, because the tongue is much above the angle of the mandible, you can see that this gentleman with high venous pressure, venous veins are engorged under the surface of the tongue. So, you know, at least the veins are engorged up to the level of the tongue and maybe above that. You can't look into the cranium. Now, there are other ways of looking at the venous pressure if it is very, very high. Now, look at this video very carefully. I'll start from the beginning. Look, initially, this is an arm almost near the forearm, near the wrist. And you see in the beginning of the... Okay, watch carefully here. The vein is engorged because the patient is in severe heart failure. And apparently, there's not much kink between the jugular vein and the axillary vein and the arm vein. Therefore, when I run it, if you look carefully, you can see the venous pulsation even in the forearm near the wrist. Now, therefore, the venous column is elevated. Now, it is intracranial, so I'm not able to measure it. So what I do is, I passively lift the arm slowly upward and upward. At one point, this venous pulsation disappears. Now, I can see the upper level of the venous column is here. And at a certain point, it disappears. And then I bring it down again. So I know which point the venous column is. From there, I draw a horizontal line and measure it above the sternal angle. Now, you watch the video carefully. Unless you look carefully, you won't see the pulsations here. Okay, now they have disappeared. Okay, now we have marked that point and frame there. You draw a vertical line to the chest and measure it, first the vertical height from the sternal angle. Now watch again. Measure from that point, a horizontal line and a vertical height from the sternal angle. So this is another way of measuring venous pressure when it is above the angle of the mandible. Now, in some cases, you may be able to do it even in the leg veins because sometimes the RA pressure is transmitted all because IVC is directly in communication in the right atrium and it goes all the way to femoral vein and even the leg vein. Therefore, if the sometimes in severe heart failure, you may be seeing visible veins on the leg and you may do the same sort of leg raising and see at what point the venous pulsations disappear and measure it the vertical height. But it's important to measure only the vertical height as is shown here. That's the most critical part. If you do a mistake in that, okay, sorry, one moment. You see, it's a vertical height like this. Now, if you happen to measure obliquely like this, then it's not valid anymore. It's only the vertical height that has to be measured. Okay. Now, in some cases, the venous pressure is borderline. You expected the JVP will be elevated, but it's not visible at all. And you expected the patient is in heart failure, but you don't find heart failure. there is a sign which is called hepatojugular reflex. Please note it is reflux and it is not a reflex. It's not a neurological reflex. Reflux means backflow of blood. Now, although it is called hepatojugular, you don't exert pressure on the liver. Please don't do that mistake. Don't press the liver. One day you'll rupture the liver. What you do is you just exert abdominal pressure in the periumbilical region. The idea is to increase the intra-abdominal pressure. When you increase the intra-abdominal pressure, it compresses the splanchnic veins and the IVC, and the blood volume is shifted towards the right atrium. That shift, rise in the right atrial pressure, will be reflected in the superior vena cava. That happens even in a normal person. But in a normal person, when an increased blood volume comes to the right atrium and right ventricle, what happens is the right ventricle immediately gets stimulated. You know the Frank Starling mechanism, increased pre-load on the muscle, so increased force of contraction, and therefore the RV will step up its activity and push out the blood. The normal RV is able to compensate, and therefore the rise in the RA pressure and the rise in the JVP is very limited, and it quickly goes away. It rises and immediately goes away because the right ventricle functions effectively and takes care of it. When the right heart is failing, for example, in cor pulmonale or in TR or organic valve disease, whatever it is, when the right ventricle is failing and you push a certain amount, the patient is on diuretic. Sometimes when you examine him, he finds that JVP is not elevated. He says he has been sick for 10 years with heart failure. He's on multiple diuretic. But when you examine him, JVP appears normal. That means it may be due to overdiuresis. In that case, when you compress the abdomen and push the volume, you find a sustained rise in the internal jugular vein pressure. And that is called a positive hepatojugular reflex. What is a positive response? There should be a rise of at least 3 centimeters in the venous pressure, and it should remain elevated for at least 50 seconds after you release your hand. That is called 15 seconds, sorry, not 50, 15 seconds. Now, a positive test basically indicates that the right ventricle is unable to handle the increased venous return. And what is the most important cause? Elevated. There is a subtle elevation of JVP which you are not able to make out, and you have brought it out by hepatojugular reflex. Even left heart filling pressure when it's elevated will reflect in hepatojugular reflex. Right ventricular failure, hypervolemia, fluid overload, tricuspid incompetence, and of course carpulmonale. Carpulmonale can produce right heart failure, but even before that, intrathoracic pressure is so high that it may have a positive jugular reflex. So once you have done with the identification of venous column, then you have measured it, then you go on to the waves. Now, you're all familiar with waves, but just for the quick revision, as you know, there are 3 positive waves, A wave, C wave, and V wave, and 2 descents, X descent and a Y descent. Some people divide the X descent into X descent and X prime descent. The portion before X, C wave is X, and then there's an X prime descent. Now, A is obviously due to atrial contraction. Then it occurs after the P wave. Although it occurs due to the P wave, there's always a delay between the electrical activity and the mechanical activity. Because after the electrical activity, the muscle has to contract. And the muscle has to contract, the pressure has to build up. And then the pressure wave has to travel to the jugular vein. Therefore, there's always a delay from the P wave to the A wave. So by the time the A wave comes, it's almost invariably on the QRS complex, right? It falls on the QRS complex. But in practice, it generally occurs slightly before the QRS complex, before the arterial pulse, because although it falls in the QRS complex, there is an electromechanical delay in the ventricle also. So although the QRS complex comes here, the arterial pulse comes somewhere here. It doesn't come immediately with the QRS complex. Therefore, the arterial pulse comes somewhere here. Therefore, an A wave comes after the P wave with the QRS complex, but it comes before the arterial pulse. Okay. Now, once the atrial wave has occurred, the A wave empties into the ventricle and the ventricle contracts. When the ventricle contracts, What happens is the AV valve closes and the AV valve bulges due to the ventricular contact. AV valve is a thin membrane. It bulges into the right atrium. Well, I'm describing for right atrium, but exactly the same sequence of events occur in the left atrium also. Okay. Now, it bulges into the right atrium and therefore it produces another small wave called the C wave. Now, why this is called a C wave is another story. People who recorded it in the neck initially thought that this was an artifact produced by a carotid pulse. That's why they named it a C wave. But now it's believed that it's due to the bulging of the AV valve into the right atrium. As the A wave contracts and the A wave empties into the right ventricle, the RA pressure drops, and that is the X descent here. Then, once the ventricle has contracted here, and then throughout systole, what happens is the atrium is the AV valve ring is pulled. It is pulled down by the ventricular contraction. The ventricular contraction contract and the AV valve is actually pulled down, and there is some amount of suction. So the initially passive emptying of the right atrium, and then there is active pulling of the AV valve down that produces a large part of the X descent. At this point, venous filling is happening continuously into the right atrium, and therefore the V wave rises. So this is atrial filling during ventricular systole. And then once the systole is over and the valve opens, the Y descent happens. The atrium empties into the right ventricle rapidly. Y descent occurs. Now, it's important to understand the mechanism. Atrial contraction, initial part of ventricular contraction, AV valve being pulled down, atrial filling in ventricular systole, and then rapid filling of the ventricle on the initial opening of the AV valve. So that's important. Now, timing is very important. A wave occurs in the PR interval or just at the onset of the QRS complex. The C wave occurs somewhere in the middle of the between the QRS complex and the T wave ventricular contraction. The X descent and the V wave are systolic events. In fact, the peak of the V occurs slightly after the systole. So this is the entire part of systole. C, X, and V. They're all systolic events. And then this is an early diastolic event. So if you were to auscultate the patient, the first heart sound occurs somewhere here, soon after the QRS complex, here. The mitral valve would close here. So the A wave would occur just before the first sound. Okay? And the V wave would occur just after the second sound. A wave just before the first sound, and the B wave occurs just after the second sound. Now, these are all very important timing, because sometimes to identify A waves and B waves, you can use the carotid pulse, you can use auscultation, you can use the apical impulse. So many ways are there. You must know exactly the timing. One of the most important diagrams in cardiology is the Vickers diagram. I don't know how many of you have understood the Vickers diagram. The Vickers diagram is one of the most important thing to understand and remember. All the cardiac events are depicted in the Vickers diagram in relation to each other. Therefore, you know exactly at what point in the cardiac cycle the A wave is happening, what point the C wave is happening, what period B wave is happening. And that helps you derive the abnormalities. Now, this shows you the timing with the vertical lines here. Can you see that? The A wave begins after the P wave at the onset of the QRS, whereas the C, X, and V are all systolic events, and V actually occurs just after the peak of the T wave. The first sound occurs after the A wave, and the second sound occurs just before the V wave. Now, how do you identify it in the bedside? Now, at the bedside, you have to time it with the carotid pulse. That's the easiest method. Which carotid pulse would you use? You have to use the opposite side. Because if you press on this side, you will not be able to see the venous pulsation. So the simplest thing to have a have a light on one side here. You look at it from here, the direction, with both light and your eyes at the same level of the skin, and you palpate the carotid pulse on the opposite side. The wave which comes just before the carotid pulse is the A wave. The wave which comes just with or after the carotid pulse is a B wave. Okay? Now, sometimes it's hard to say just before, just after. Sometimes you have to make an admit. Are these synchronous or not? You know, are they coming together or not coming together? That's all you need to make out. You don't have to say just before, just after and all. There's no need to make. Are they coming together or are they not coming together? If they're not coming together, it must be A wave. If they're coming together, it must be B wave. As simple as that. Okay? Now, I'm going to show you some abnormal video recordings of jugular vein pulse. I'll ask you, some of you to identify, please get ready, and some of you must be ready to answer. Don't worry if you're wrong. Now, all these are classical examples of abnormal jugular vein. Okay? Now, I know you don't have the advantage of carotid timing, but in all cases, you will be able to see the carotid pulse as a jerky movement here, or just in front of the ear, you will feel the temporal artery pulse here. You have to learn to look at the jugular vein and this pulse simultaneously. Just both and see whether they are coming together or not coming together. Okay? Yeah, one of you get ready for answering. I'm going to stop it for some time and ask you. Yeah, somebody wants to answer? What do you think?
Sir, is
there a large T wave PR?
Yeah, who is answering? Hello?
Yeah, sir. Okay. Sir, yes, sir.
Yeah, identify yourself and start talking.
Sir, myself, Sunil Jattanian.
Okay.
Sir, this we can see, sir, the large V waves that are coinciding with the carotid pulses that are seen below the ear. It might be a large V wave, hence around maybe TR.
Okay. That's a good attempt. Let's start step by step. One, you can see that the venous pulse is elevated because you can see the venous pulsations are very widespread behind the sternocleidomastoid. It is visible almost till here. It's an abnormal venous pulse. Now, the carotid pulse is seen here. The best place to see is the temporal artery pulse here. Okay. Now, one of the characteristics is this wave is a very, very short-lived flickering wave. Right? It comes and goes immediately. Isn't it right? Like you cannot see me. It's like almost a sharp upstroke and a sharp downstroke. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
It almost looks like an arterial pulse, no? Sharp upstroke and sharp downstroke. Yes. And if you watch carefully, this is not coming with the pulse. This is arterial pulse here, where my finger is here. They are not synchronous. Keep your eye on this, but in the periphery of your eye vision, you must be seeing this. Your vision should be here, but your periphery should be seeing them. They are not coming together. I don't know whether you're able to make out. Anyway, so these are not large V waves. These are large A waves. This is the characteristic of an A wave is it's a very short-lived, sharp flick. Flick in the sense, it's a very sharp upstroke and a sharp downstroke. That is characteristic of an A wave. Now, V wave, on the other hand, when it is prominent enough to come into the neck, as you said in TR, usually is an expansile wave. No, expansile means what? No? The vein will get distended from below, and as it fills, the whole vein will become distended from below upwards like this. That's a slow expansile wave. I'll show you some TR later. Now, this is a typical flicking A wave. And if you are able to time it with the pulse, it is not coinciding with the pulse. So these are large A waves. Large A waves means what? What does large A wave mean? Hello? Come on, guys, quick. Large A wave. Go ahead.
Against the RVEDP and RVF.
No, you're not explaining the mechanism. A large A wave indicates that the atrial contraction is very strong. And the atrial contraction is strong enough to produce high RAA pressure. Why that happens is because there is some resistance to flow of blood from RA into RV. So the RA has to contract much more strongly than usual. Now this is what this wave looks like. See, the wave is a sharp upstroke and a sharp downstroke. Now because the A wave is so strong, the second wave is very, very small and you don't even notice it. If you look carefully at the root of the neck, actually there are two waves, one sharp big one and another small one there. Okay, so this is a prominent A wave. Now, prominent A wave generally indicates difficulty in emptying from right atrium to right ventricle, and the central column is the most common cause. Whenever the right ventricle is hypertrophied due to pulmonary stenosis or any cause of pulmonary hypertension, the right ventricular EDP is elevated. Therefore, the RAA wave has to be bigger than the RVEDP. Or maybe cardiomyopathy, pulmonary embolism raises the RV pressure, and right ventricular infarction, very important. The most common causes of large A wave are the causes of diminished RV compliance due to right ventricular hypertrophy or right ventricular issues like myocardial infarction. Yes, the other causes are less common. There is an obstruction of the tricuspid valve, either due to tricuspid stenosis or right atrial myxoma or in congenitally obstructed tricuspid atresia. These are slightly less common. And another less common cause, although known as the Bernheim effect. You must have heard of the Bernheim effect. When you have disease on the left side, severe aortic stenosis or HOCM, the septum is so hypertrophied and bulging into the right ventricle that the RVEDP is also elevated, and therefore RA filling is stronger, RA contraction is stronger, and the A wave is prominent. So it can be a Bernheim effect. The large venous wave on the right side due to disease on the left side. There are also conditions called reverse Bernheim effect, you must have heard of. When the right ventricle is severely hypertrophied, the septum bulges into the left side and cause that we won't go into now. Okay, these are the causes of a prominent large A wave. Now sometimes the A wave may not be seen. Well, A waves are generally identified in most people, but very obese, short neck, you may not be seen. But the A waves are truly absent only if there is no effective contraction in atrial fibrillation. Or sometimes when the heart rate is very fast, what happens is the A wave may fuse with the preceding, because the diastole becomes shorter and shorter, and therefore the A wave may fuse with the preceding V wave, and the A wave may not be seen completely. Especially the preceding V wave is very large. Suppose heart failure, tricuspid incompetence, and marked tachycardia, you just cannot make out a separate A wave. Okay? Now, the previous patient was the case of pulmonary stenosis. Now, here's a lady with pulmonary hypertension. Can you see this? She's sitting up. You can see that. Again, it's a very... Now, you can see in the shadow here, the movement of the carotid pulse. Yes? And you can see clearly behind the sternomastoid, it is the internal jugular vein pulse. Again, the venous pressure is elevated. Very flicking, sharp movements, and these are, which are not coinciding with the carotid pulse. So these are sharp A wave, and this lady had severe pulmonary arterial hypertension. So large A wave, one due to pulmonary stenosis and one due to pulmonary hypertension. Now, at the moment, you're not able to palpate the carotid, and that's the difficulty in timing. But even now, if you concentrate your vision on this spot, and in the periphery of the vision, you will see this movement is much bigger, easily seen. So you keep watching here at the periphery of the moment, you see this moment and this moment are not coinciding. So these are large A waves. Now that's easy. Who wants to talk about that? Hello? Somebody come on. This is one of the easiest ones.
Yes, sir. Large V wave, sir.
Describe it. No? Use some terms to know, tell me that you have understood. I just told you a few minutes ago the difference between A wave and V wave. So your description should tell me that you have understood.
Yes, sir. A wave can be seen a little flickering, followed by a V wave which is surging, sir.
These are large expansile. Can you see the vein expanding from below upward like a wave? From the sternum, it's going upward like an expansile wave. These are large expansile V waves. Okay?
Yes.
And when the V waves are that big, often with tachycardia, the A wave may not be seen very well, as I told you last time. But you can see all the veins are engorged, and you can see large expansile waves on the right side. You can see on the left side also it's moving. You can see the vein, and obviously the patient is very tachypneic. So these are large V waves of. Now, what has happened here is, in tricuspid incompetence, when the valve closes, it starts leaking. Therefore, there is no isovolemic contraction phase at all. Isovolemic contraction phase is a phase when the ventricle is raising its pressure, but there is no change in volume. But when the valve is leaking, therefore, there is no isovolemic contraction phase. Right from the moment valve closes, leak starts. Therefore, the X descent is obliterated. I'll show you how it happens. Now, look at this. This is a prominent A wave. Prominent A wave here, but the X descent is preserved and a small Y occurs. Now, when you have tricuspid incompetence, after the A wave, the X descent is obliterated. There is no isovolemic contraction at all. Immediately, the regurgitation starts into the jugular vein or into the right atrium. And the entire X descent, the C wave, and the remaining portion of the X descent and the V wave, all of them merge into one big positive CV wave. So you have an obliteration of the X descent, the C wave, and the V wave. All of them merge into one positive wave, which is called the prominent V wave, also known as the CV wave. Because it actually starts in early systole and continues into late systole. Therefore, it is a combination of C and V, CV wave. And that indicates severe tricuspid incompetence. The features of tricuspid incompetence is obliteration of the X descent and obliteration of the C wave, and a conversion of X and C wave into a large positive CV wave that indicates severe tricuspid incompetence. So when the V wave abnormal, the V wave abnormality indicates a direct reflection of the incompetence at the valve, and also it's a reflection of the RA blood volume. When the RA blood volume is there, the V wave will be large. Therefore, a very prominent V wave in the neck, tricuspid incompetence, large ASD, because normally the A wave is larger in the right side and B wave is larger in the left side. But when you have an ASD with MR, the MR wave can be actually large ASD with MR. In that case, the MR wave can actually transmit through the ASD into the neck. Okay? Severe heart failure. Your body defect is the defect where LV to RA shunt. That means from the left ventricle, the jet of VSD comes directly into the right atrium, and therefore that produces a large V wave. When atrial fibrillation occurs, the A wave disappears and the venous pressure is very high, and therefore the V wave is large. And Actually, there are not many conditions where the venous waves are small, but if at all you have to name something, it's hypovolemia and vasodilator when the venous pressure is very, very low. Okay, so the V waves are important only when they are large and abnormal. Now, I mentioned sometime earlier that in the venous column, it's important to note the waves, but sometimes it's also equally important to note the descent. Now, in a patient who is congestive heart failure, the venous pressure is high, but the valve opens, it empties, because the RA pressure is very high, it empties into the ventricle very rapidly. Therefore, the descents are always very sharp. Now, look at this lady here. She has got markedly elevated venous pressure. You can see the venous pulsations right up to the upper part of her neck. You can see two waves for every cardiac cycle in the neck. But after the A wave and after the B wave, you see the descents are very nicely seen and sharp. X descent and Y descents are very nicely seen. In fact, the descents are more easily seen than the positive wave. Now compare this with this patient. Now here also you are seeing two waves. Here also the venous pressure is quite elevated. Now can you see the outward movement is expansile like a TR, but when it goes back, it is somewhat slower as compared to this one. This is a brisk X and Y descent, whereas this descent is very gradual. Now, when does the descent become gradual? Whenever the filling from the right atrium to the right ventricle is slow. And when does that happen? That happens if the RV compliance is very, very poor. RV is very, very stiff. Therefore, the RA emptying to RV is very slow. Or there is obstruction of the tricuspid valve, tricuspid stenosis. The Y descent becomes slow. Can you see the difference between the descents in this picture, in this video and this video? There's a difference between the two. Now, in this case, the venous pressure is very high and the descents are slow. Now, look at this video. This is also another example of tricuspid incompetence. But can you see that the expansile movement due to TR is very large. It goes up to all the neck. But although the venous pressure is very high, the backward movement downward into the collapse of the vein occurs gradually. That indicates, along with tricuspid incompetence, there is some tricuspid stenosis. As you know, that rheumatic heart disease, TR, is almost always accompanied by tricuspid stenosis. Therefore, this is an example of a tricuspid regurgitation with some degree of tricuspid stenosis. That's it. Slowing of the Y descent. Now this will require some experience, but the best comparison I can show you this one. You can see the sharp descents here and compare it with and the one on the right side and look at the descents here. This is a gradual descent. The venous pressure drops gradually. So it's a combination of TR with TS. So what is happening is in both the cases, the X descent and the C wave are obliterated, both the cases. In pure TR, the X descent is obliterated and the C wave also disappears. It forms a CV wave. But the Y descent remains sharp in pure TR. Y descent remains sharp in Y here. In typical congestive heart failure without TS, organic tricuspid valve disease, this is what happened. There is a large V wave and a sharp Y descent. On the other hand, in the presence of organic tricuspid valve disease, you have an A wave and then the X descent and C wave are obliterated. Therefore, you have a CV wave, but the Y descent is gradual. It doesn't occur sharply like this. It occurs gradually. So that's the difference between TR alone and TS in TR. And the neck vein is the only clue to the diagnosis of TS in the bedside. There's no other clinical clue to the bedside diagnosis of tricuspid stenosis. So when do you get abnormal descent of the Y? A rapid Y descent may occur in certain conditions, particularly when there is elevated venous pressure and in some other condition which I will talk to you. But a slow void descent occurs when RA emptying is impaired, which occurs in tricuspid stenosis, when there is obstruction due to a myxoma, or when ventricular filling is impaired by cardiac compression due to fluid or blood or whatever it is. Okay? So that is a cause of slow void descent. Now there are other causes of sharp void descent, which I'll come to now. Now watch carefully this video. Somebody has to now answer. This is another video. His heart rate is normal. I know you can't see the carotid pulse. You can actually see it here. Carefully, if you watch here, you see the carotid pulse. But atrial rate is 90. Arterial rate is 90 per minute. So it's normal. Some volunteers. Make an attempt. Come on.
Yes, sir. Sir, the descents are very slow and gradual, sir. That's what.
The descents are very.
Slow and gradual, sir. Slow descents. But I'm not able to make out which one. Is.
Okay. Is the venous pressure normal or high?
It is high, sir. About high. 3 cm.
Well, the patient is sitting up, and yes, you can see that the venous column is. You can see actually venous pulsation right till here, almost angle of the mandible. Okay, now one moment. The beginning of the you watch here. See that the internal jugular vein pulsation, you can see here. Now, watch carefully the internal jugular pulsation, or even here you can see here also. Okay, now there are two waves, and the descents are very sharp. It looks like two descents rather than two waves. Watch carefully here. Can you see that? Two flickering waves and two descents. Watch here also.
Okay, sir.
Why do you say descent is not sharp? It is a very sharp descent. See, the skin is pulled in very sharply. And there are two waves per cardiac cycle. You agree with that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what you are seeing is the venous pressure is elevated. I can see both A and V waves clearly. Both appear to be equal. No? Both are appear to be equal. One doesn't appear to be unduly bigger than the other. But most characteristic is I find both the X descent and the Y descent are very sharp. They appear to be very jerky and sharp. This is the classical finding of constrictive pericarditis. A M pattern. M pattern means A and V wave are equal.
Equal.
The venous pressure is elevated. And X descent and Y descent are sharp. These are the classical. It's a very subtle sign. No? Unless you look carefully, you will never pick it. This neck looks normal. If you don't examine properly, you will pass it off as normal. The venous pressure is elevated. Two sharp waves are seen and two sharp descents are seen. Descent means indrawing, collapse of the vein are seen. And the indrawing is very sharp. That's one of the classical features of constrictive pericarditis, because the constrictive pericardium forms a hard shell. And when the beginning of diastole, when the ventricle opens, filling occurs rapidly because you. And then at the end of the filling, suddenly it stops. That's all. So sharp filling and stop. Therefore, it gives almost like arterial, say you get a water hammer pulse, not like me. Sharp movement and stop. Sharp movement and stop. That is why you get that sharp descent. Do you understand?
Okay,
so this is a classical M pattern in the jugular vein of a constrictive pericarditis. Three cardinal features: increased venous pressure, equal A and V waves, and sharp X and Y descent. Here is another example. Same thing. Look, again, if you look casually, you will never detect it. But one thing you will agree that the venous pressure is elevated, almost the angle of the mandible here. Okay, but the pulsations are very widespread. Watch here. Again, you see two waves. Okay, and it's not a very good video recording, but you can see carefully here. Keep watching here. You see two waves and two descents, sharp descents. This is not as good as the previous case. Okay?
Okay, sir.
So again, venous pressure is elevated, two waves, two descents, both are equal and the descents are sharp. Another case of constrictive pericarditis. Now, this is what happens in constrictive pericarditis. Both are equal and therefore that's called an M pattern. Some people even call it a W pattern. And it also looks like a W. Yeah, but some people call it M pattern, A wave and a V wave. The X descent is very sharp and the Y descent is also very sharp. That's what you're seeing in the neck. Yes, this figure and this diagram match here. Now, there is another condition in which both A and B are equal. Normally, I said A is the right atrium, the A is larger, and the left atrium, V is larger. But when there is an ASD, what happens is A and V become equal. Now, ASD, when there is no MR, I'm talking. Therefore, A and V become equal. So, constrictive pericarditis is one cause of M pattern. Atrial septal defect is another cause of M pattern. But the difference is, in constrictive pericarditis, the venous pressure will be high, whereas in ASD, the venous pressure will be normal. Is that simple? A normal venous pressure with equal A and V wave is found in ASD, atrial septal defect. Equal A and V wave sharp descent with elevated venous pressure is found in constrictive pericarditis. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So atrial septal defect, also don't be surprised if you find A and V equal. Next time you examine atrial septal defect, most of us don't even look at the jugular vein in the case of ASD. Everybody said ASD is like white split second sound, chalo device closure kar denge. That is the approach. If you look carefully at the jugular vein, you will find a M pattern with equal in A and V waves. Okay, so jugular veins are very important pericardial disease, especially when it comes to differentiating between tamponade and constrictive pericarditis. Both of them, the jugular venous pressure is elevated. Okay. In constrictive pericarditis, I just told you A and V are equal and prominent and the descents are very prominent because the ventricular filling is very rapid. On the other hand, when there is compression due to fluid or mass or anything, cardiac tamponade, the ventricular filling is impaired because of the compression. And therefore, the X descent and Y descent are obliterated. High pressure with no sharp and XY descent, more favor of tamponade. High venous pressure, sharp X and Y descent, more in favor of constrictive pericarditis. Okay? Now watch this video carefully. Yes, anybody answering?
Seems to be Sir Kusmal sign.
Yes, good. So this is a long video recording just to show you the real dose. Whenever he takes an inspiration, you see the venous pressure is rising up. Yes, clearly seen? Now you must, Kusumal sign is said to be characteristic of? Of what?
Are we failure meaning?
Okay. So it's not characteristic of anything. One of the signs of constrictive pericarditis, but it's not only found in constrictive pericarditis, it's found in a number of conditions. So one has to understand the mechanism of Kusumal sign. With inspiration, normally the intrathoracic pressure falls and the right atrial filling increases, and therefore the veins collapse into the right atrium. But in some conditions, the RA pressure is already very high due to right heart failure or tricuspid incompetence or constrictive pericarditis or whatever. The RA pressure is already 20. It cannot fill more with inspiration. Therefore, in that situation, the venous pressure will not drop, or it may actually go up in the neck due to inspiration. And that is the mechanism of the normal heart. When inspiration occurs, the more blood comes into the right atrium, it's accommodated and it's handled by the right ventricle. But when the RA pressure is elevated already due to RV failure or constrictive pericarditis, this cannot happen. So the number of causes of Kussmaul sign, it's described in constrictive pericarditis, but it's found in a number of conditions which applies to any cause of a high right atrial pressure. Constrictive pericarditis, right heart failure, tricuspid stenosis, RV infarction, cardiomyopathy, and even acute pulmonary embolism. If you have an acute patient with positive Kussmaul sign, you think of pulmonary embolism. That's an important finding. Okay? Right.
Yes, sir.
Right. Let's go to this. Now, this is a young patient who came to the ER with some discomfort and breathing difficulty. One second. Yes, somebody has to volunteer.
Canon A waves.
Yeah, describe it. No, don't. You can't say just canon wave. No? The diagnosis doesn't give you any marks in the examination, I can tell you that. Unless, because sometimes you do get the diagnosis right, but you're not able to explain it, then you don't get any credit for it. Unless you report it properly, I won't give you any credit for this diagnosis.
Yes.
First of all, tell me, is it fast or slow, whether it's regular or irregular, what is the description of the wave, is it a venous wave or an arterial wave? You're not telling me anything. Suddenly you're saying canon wave.
Sir, first is JVP pressure, it looks like 3 cm above the clavicle, sir. Is in sitting position. And then coming to waves, it is.
Is it abnormal or normal? First, tell me.
Abnormal, sir.
Abnormal. Why?
So because there is a. The A wave was very vigorous, like the.
Huh? Sorry.
They are very prominent, sir. So okay. The A wave, they are very large, they are very prominent.
How do you know they are A waves? How do you know that?
So either we have to time with carotid, sir.
Unfortunately, you don't have carotid today.
Yes.
Patient is having some problem in the ER room. You are not able to feel the pulse. So don't. Tell me whatever is available. You have to tell me. You have not described the wave. That's why I am asking all these questions. I told you, the A waves have a very characteristic appearance. A wave is a very sharp flicking wave. By the way, this is arterial pulse or a venous pulse?
So both are seen, sir, side by side.
That's the easiest answer.
The lateral, yes.
Which artery appears outside the sternocleidomastoid muscle? whole skin outside the sternocleidomastoid muscle is pulsating. Which artery is there? Unless there is a large carotid artery aneurysm.
Yes, sir.
I told you, no, all the carotid pulses occur in front of the sternocleidomastoid. It should occur, carotid pulse will occur here.
Yes, sir.
What is the problem? Even without palpating, you should tell me that these are venous pulses. And the subclavian artery is below the clavicle. You won't see it.
Clavicle, yes.
So these are venous pulsations. And they are rapid. And they are regular. And now comes to the point, what pulsation they are. You like, they are atrial contractions or atrial filling? Which one? Atrial contractions are short. Atrial filling are slow yes. and expansile. I told you just now, no? A waves are short and sharp.
Yes, sir. Atrial contraction.
B waves are slow and expansile.
Atrial contraction, sir.
Okay. So these are due to atrial contractions. Now, we don't have the carotid pulse to compare. But for some reason, the atrial pulse, the atrial wave, A wave is occurring at a very, very fast. But this A wave is very abnormal, no? Very low, very big. No? Do you see A wave that big? The whole root of the neck pulsates. So they appear to be very giant-sized A waves. So one of the causes of giant-sized A wave, other than is if you time it to the carotid pulse, if it comes with the pulse, then they are known as Cannon waves. So these are regular, sharp, very large A waves. Actually, when the A waves are to be called A waves only if they occur in pre-systole, before the onset of systole. If an A wave occurs during systole, they are called as Cannon waves. Some people use the word Cannon A waves, but strictly speaking, A waves are pre-systolic and Cannon waves are systolic. So these are regular large A waves or regular large Cannon A waves or regular large Cannon waves. And what causes regular Cannon waves?
SVT.
Huh?
Complete heart block.
First I heard SVT and then I heard complete heart block. Then what is the third person saying?
Junctional rhythm.
Junctional rhythm. Can you qualify it? See, I don't think any of you is correct.
Sir.
When there is large to be Cannon wave, it means that the atrium is contracting on a closed AV valve. The A wave is occurring during ventricular systole. When does atrium and ventricle contract together? When there is junctional tachycardia.
There are a lot of causes.
Yeah, a lot of causes. Why didn't you tell me some? You are not telling me anything.
CHV, frequent VPC, VT, junctional tachycardia.
Excuse me, this is a regular Cannon wave. You mean ventricular ectopic will occur this regularly like this?
No, sir. So, ventricular bihegemony.
Cause of regular Cannon wave, there are only two causes. One is AV junctional tachycardia. Junctional tachycardia causes the atrium and ventricle to contract together. And therefore, you get regular Cannon waves. The other cause is ventricular tachycardia. Ventricular tachycardia with 1:1 retrograde conduction. 1:1 retrograde conduction. Therefore, the only two causes of regular Cannon waves, regular fast Cannon waves in the neck. Junctional tachycardia and ventricular tachycardia, both of them having retrograde atrial conduction. When this boy had an ECG, this is what he had. Can you see the rhythm? You can see that the rate is fast, narrow QRS, and you can see the P wave and the QRS occurring together. The P is seen just before the QRS, and the P and QRS occurring together. So this is an example of a fast junctional tachycardia causing regular Cannon waves. Now, somebody said junctional rhythm. When you say junctional rhythm, the rate is generally slow. The rate should be in the range of 40 to 60 per minute. If you say rapid regular Cannon wave should be junctional tachycardia. Secondly, junctional rhythm usually does not have 1:1 retrograde conduction. Junctional rhythm usually has AV dissociation. That means atrium and ventricle beat independent of each other. In that case, you will get irregular Cannon waves. You will not get regular Cannon waves. You will get irregular Cannon waves. Okay, this is an example of regular fast Cannon wave due to junctional tachycardia, or it can be a VT also. You have to be careful. Now look at this example. This is an example of a slow junctional. No, look at the junctional rhythm with 1:1 conduction, or junctional rhythm with AV. No, AV dissociation not marked. Both of them are nearly at the same rate, and therefore you are getting a large Cannon wave occurring at a slow regular rate. Now, Cannon wave sometimes can be very difficult to differentiate from a large V wave because both are systolic, both are large, and both are expansive. So sometimes a large V wave and a Cannon wave can be mistaken. For example, this may very well be mistaken for a V wave, isn't it? But then you have to judge. The rate is slow. You can see that the rate is less than 50 per minute. So a slow regular Cannon wave is an indication of slow junctional rhythm. Previous one was junctional tachycardia. This is slow junctional rhythm. You have to be careful to differentiate from tricuspid incompetence, and that will tell you, other signs tell you, presence of valvular heart disease, presence of a TR murmur, presence of a pulsatile liver, presence of hepatomegaly and heart failure, all those associated signs will tell you. Now watch carefully here. This is again the neck. This is the clavicle. That is the shoulder here, and that is the neck. Okay, so this is the sternomastoid muscle. Yeah, who is going to answer? Hello?
Nikhil, we can name our friends, I think.
I can't hear you. Say that again.
No, sir. We'll name out our friends who will volunteer, sir.
Yeah, I think nobody is answering. No, we are wasting time.
Dr. Deepthi, Dr.
Murthy, sir. If you are not immediately answering, no, there's no point in having an interactive session. I'm taking a lot of pain to get this recordings and all this for you. Unless you people are interactive, there's no point.
Yes. Dr. Sharon, Sharon, ma'am, can you just take it? Sharon, ma'am.
I already gave you the clue. No, this is very simple. I've already given you a clue.
Sir, this is Nitesh, sir. Sir, I can see, sir, some irregular expansile waves, I can see, sir, in between, sir. And there are some waves are seen, but irregularly, I can see some expansile waves in the neck, sir, which is around 3 to 4 centimeter raised from the clavicle, sir, midpoint of clavicle.
Okay.
So it maybe the irregular Cannon waves, maybe.
Okay. Are they sharp or the expansile? Are they rapidly coming and rapidly going away? Or they are
No, sir. Not rapid. Rapidly going away, sir. It's rapidly
then
going
why do
away,
you call
sir.
It expansile wave? These are very sharp waves. I just showed you an example of regular Cannon wave. This is a typical example of an irregular Cannon wave. See, most of the time you don't see the venous pulse, it's not even visible. And suddenly you see one large pulse.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
See that big one?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
One big one now. Right? Very sharp wave, but immediately it goes away. These are not V wave. These are A wave, which come in during ventricular systole. But these are not coming with every systole. They are not coming in every cardiac cycle. Therefore, yes, these are Cannon waves which are irregular. Now, irregular Cannon wave, what are the cause? Now you can tell me the causes of irregular Cannon wave.
Sir, one is complete heart block, sir.
Complete heart block.
One is frequent VPC, sir.
Frequent VPCs.
Sir, then VT with the without 1:1 retrograde conduction. Slow VT.
Okay. So slow VT. So now what is this case? This is an example of a VPC. See, initially the venous pressure is normal and You see here, the venous pressure is normal and you're getting a normal A wave and V wave. And suddenly when you get a ventricular ectopic, now this ventricular ectopic is occurring exactly where a normal QRS is supposed to occur. Right? The A wave exactly at the point where A wave is contracting, exactly at the point where the A wave is P wave is supposed to occur. A P, P and P. Exactly at the time of the next P, a ventricular ectopic has happened. So when the A wave contracted, the ventricle has closed the AV valve. The AV valve is closed and the A wave also happened at the same time. That produces a giant A wave in the atrium, which is known as the Cannon wave. Now this is called Cannon wave because it's very large, but the important difference is, unlike a wave which occurs before ventricular contraction, before the QRS complex, this A wave occurs during the QRS complex. So this is a systolic event, whereas A wave is a presystolic event. Now the way I define it is A wave is a presystolic and Cannon wave is systolic. But some people like to use it, that is, one is A wave, another is Cannon A wave. Now it's up to you, but I like to differentiate the two. So these are irregular Cannon wave. Now why it occurs is, only occasionally the VPCs come, and occasionally this VPC and P wave occur together. Similarly, in a complete heart block, there is AV dissociation in complete heart block. Therefore, occasionally that idioventricular beat comes, and at the same time the atrium contracts. Therefore, it produces an irregular Cannon wave intermittently. So that's the list of causes. Regular Cannon wave, junctional rhythm. I showed you one junctional rhythm. VT with 1:1 retrograde conduction and isarrhythmic AV dissociation. Whereas now this and this will be slow. So junctional rhythm and this will be slow. And this will be fast. Irregular Cannon waves, complete heart block will be a slow but irregular Cannon wave. AV dissociation will be slow and irregular Cannon wave. VT will be fast pulse, but the Cannon wave will be irregular, slow. VVI pacing will produce the irregular Cannon wave. Next time you have a VVI pacemaker patient, if you look in the neck, you will get beautiful Cannon waves. And of course, ventricular ectopic, that I already showed you. So these are examples of regular Cannon waves and irregular Cannon waves. And I've shown you a video of both. Okay, I think that's the end, I think. So I've tried to show you the anatomy.